அவங்க பார்ட்டிசிபென்ட் ஸ்டார்ட் பண்றது
இல்ல நான் ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணிருக்கேன் நீங்க மேம் கிட்ட ஓகேவா ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணலாம்
பார்ட்டிசிபென்ட்ஸ் ஹலோ மேம்
ஹலோ
மேம் ஷல் வி ஸ்டார்ட் மேம்
யா யா ஷூர் வி கேன்
ஓகே மேம் சார் அன்மியூட் ஆகி கொடுங்க சார் சார் வீடியோ அன்மியூட் ஆகி கொடுக்க முடியுமா வீடியோ மியூட் இல்ல மியூட் இல்ல நிறைய பேர் பார்ட்டிசிபென்ட்ஸ் தான் மேம் ஸ்கிரீன் ஷேர் பண்ண சொல்லுவா கொடுத்த உடனே ஹலோ மேம்
ஹலோ
மேம் உங்க ஸ்கிரீன் ஷேர் பண்ணிக்கிறீங்களா மேம் ஹலோ மேம் ஹலோ குட் மார்னிங் மேம்
யா குட் மார்னிங்
ஹலோ எவ்ரிவன் அண்ட் குட் மார்னிங் டு ஆல் ஆன் பிஹாஃப் ஆஃப் ஐக்யூஏசி அண்ட் டிபார்ட்மெண்ட் ஆஃப் கம்ப்யூட்டர் சயின்ஸ் அண்ட் இன்ஜினியரிங் அரசு இன்ஜினியரிங் காலேஜ் கும்பகோணம் இட் டேக்ஸ் அன் இமன்ஸ் பிளஷர் இன் வெல்கமிங் யூ ஆல் இன் திஸ் செபினார் ஆன் தி டைட்டில் கோவிட் 19 அனாலிசிஸ் யூசிங் பைத்தான் அண்ட் டபிள்யூ I am grateful to welcome our respected principal sir Dr. T Balamurugan respected VP ma'am Dr. Kalaimani Shanmugam respected dean sir Dr. M Rukmangadan beloved faculty members of CSE department I am very happy and proud to welcome our resource person Mrs. Parvati Nair IG School of Business Data Science and Telecommunications Pune I welcome all the beloved participants for this webinar expecting to have an effective and useful session today Now I call upon Mrs. B. Divya to introduce our chief guest.
Good morning to all. Now welcome our today's chief guest, Mrs. Parvati Nair, ma'am. Currently she is a research scholar at AG School of Business, Data Science, Cyber Security and Telecommunication, Pune, Maharashtra. Her education. Ma'am completed her master degree in the field of computer science at SMK Pharma Institute of Technology in 2013, completed her bachelor degree in the field of information technology at Baylor College of Engineering and Technology in 2011. Her work experiences are, she worked as assistant professor at Nauroji Wadaya College, Pune, India, from July 2017 to November 2017. She worked as assistant professor at MGM College of Engineering and Technology, Mumbai, from March to December 2016. Worked as programmer, additional skill acquisition program secretariat at Trivandrum from September 2014 to February 2015. She worked as computer science teacher at Al Kozama International School, Daman, Saudi Arabia, from September 2013 to January 2014. She is expert in the skills such as C++, Java. Now I hand over the session to our resource person, Mrs. Parvati Nair, ma'am. Ma'am, kindly, ma'am.
A very good morning to all the participants and to all the delegates. I think I should start by thanking you all, especially Sudha ma'am for giving me this opportunity to share a project that basically I just did for you know, just spending some time on analyzing the COVID-19 data. So I am really grateful to you all for giving me this opportunity, and I am also grateful to all the participants. You know, I believe most of you must be at your homes, and you know, it must not always be feasible to actually join a webinar from home, but I see there are almost 90 to 100 participants, so that's a, you know, that's kind of a huge number. So I thank all the participants also taking the time and the effort to actually join a webinar. I am basically based out of Pune, and as you all must be following the news, you know, pretty fervently, so you must be knowing that the situation in Maharashtra is kind of very, you know, it's a pretty bad situation here. So I've been locked down in my house. My husband and I, we have been in our home since the end of March. It's almost 3 months now. So luckily, our society is providing us with good facilities. That's why we've not faced any issues. But anyways, the situation here, you know, it's going to take a lot of time. So actually, I got this idea of, you know, I just to let you know my, you know, field of work, I'm actually into the data science field as a lecturer or a research scholar, if you may. The students who are taking the course or the program with Aegis School of Data Science, and there are other courses also that we offer, like cybersecurity and AI. So I am basically into the data science field, and I am basically handling subjects for these data science students, which is SQL, Python, and visualization, and the R language. So I'm basically concentrated on these subjects as of now. You know, when you're dealing with all these subjects, one thing that comes, you know, that you always deal with is the availability of data, right? So I believe, yeah, and before I actually go into much more detail, I believe you all have the option of chatting with me.
Yes, ma'am.
If you want, you can, if you want, if you have any doubts, or if you want to, you know, do any discussion, you can either message on the chat, or you can just, you know, unmute your mic and you can question me anytime, right? So because all of you are faculties, I think we do not need to conduct it like a one-way session. We can make it interactive. Anytime, if you think you want to ask me something or you want to discuss something, you can just prompt me by unmuting your mic and or giving me a message in the chat, right?
So, excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah, please tell
ma'am,
me.
Ma'am, please be little louder, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah, sure.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. So, like I was saying, when you're into the field of data science, the thing that you know, almost stumble upon any time is data, right? So anywhere and everywhere, there is huge, huge, huge amount of data. And what would be the right thing to do it is to put to good use of that data. Okay, so you have structured data, you have unstructured data, but data by itself is not of any use to anyone, right? So only if you perform some sort of work on it, right? So basically your data in the raw format is not of much use to anyone. Okay, I am getting a message saying that some of the people have not yet joined for the webinar. Do I need to... wait for them. Okay. So I believe all of you are familiar with this, you know, hype about the data science field that is going on right now. And that is simply because of the available. So we have a term that goes on, you know, data is the, a sentence that we keep repeating, data is the new oil. Okay, so you know, when oil was actually discovered, it was such a big hype, you know, everyone was putting all their money and resources into the oil industry. That's the kind of situation that we have now, right? So there is huge amount of data and everyone is putting their resources and time and effort into making use of this data. So when I say making use of this data, I'm trying to convert this data into knowledge, right? Into knowledge. And when I convert it into knowledge, that's when I am able to make use of it, gain insights from it. So that's the main purpose behind any sort of analysis that we do. Okay. So I hope my screen is visible to you all. If it's okay, can just anyone just send a yes on the chat? So I'll just tell you what we are planning, what I'm planning to cover in the session today. All of you being from a academic background would obviously have an idea of what is data science, because I believe it's part of the curriculum also, machine learning and subjects as such. So, you know, that is the thing that we'll be discussing firstly. Then the topic of web scraping. So what is web scraping, how it can be done, right? And then we'll move on to data analysis. So
this particular question, ma'am.
Yes?
Ma'am, 1 minute, ma'am. Participants, yeah. Please kindly.
Hello? Hello?
Ma'am?
Yeah, may I? Hello,
ma'am,
may I
continue? Ma'am, some of the participants still not muted, ma'am.
Okay.
We just informed them, ma'am. You can start, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, okay. Right. So, like I was saying, this particular portion is actually done entirely in Python programming. And then I have used a tool called as Tableau. Okay, so Tableau is one of the tools which is used for visualizations. It's a BI tool or a business intelligence tool. So I have used a data set that was available on Kaggle, and I've used that to create a dashboard in Tableau. So I'll come to all these in detail one by one. So anyone, you know, you can just maybe message me on chat. What is the basic idea that you have about data science? Can anyone please send me a message on chat? Or at least if you have an idea of what the topic is, data science. Okay, fine. So I believe most of you would be having an idea. Even otherwise, let me just introduce the topic to you. Right. So basically what I've shown here in this slide is nothing but a data science life cycle. So all of you must be familiar with the software development life cycle. Data science life cycle is more or less similar, but because we are talking about data science, it is focusing a lot on your data, right? So as always, there is the first step, which is business understanding. And once that is done, we move into the first important step, which is data collection, right? So we can collect data from lots and lots of sources, right? You can have something called a structured data, which is neatly organized, arranged. There are no missing values, or there might be a missing few missing values which you can handle, right? So data which is neat and clean, which you do not have to do any sort of work on, you can directly go into the analysis part, that would be the structured data. Whereas unstructured data would be some, like, you know, some anything. It could just be a script and from that you're retrieving your data, right? Or any data which is not in the form that is usable for your next step of modeling and analysis. Right? So collecting this data can be done from any of the sources. So depending on what kind of work you're doing, you might have to go to a specific source and collect the data, which again involves a lot of steps. One way we do data collection is by something called as web scraping, right? So web scraping is nothing but you're collecting data from web pages or websites, right? So information which is available online on these web pages and websites, we crawl through them, okay? And we collect that information in something called as a data frame, right? And then we move on to the next step, which is called as data preparation. So the data that we have collected, right, it's not always something that can be directly used for your analysis and modeling work, right? So data preparation is one of the steps which consumes almost 60% of your entire data science life cycle. But also, ironically, it is the most boring step, because sometimes you have no idea how you can go about doing this. I'll just want to give you a simple example. I have actually given the permission to all the students. I am able to do it. Only 6 people are waiting. I don't know why. I think they have some network issues or something. Right? So yeah, coming back to the data preparation step. So in this particular step, I am trying to clean the data to remove values which will later on in my modeling step affect my model's accuracy, right? So I'll give you one simple example. We have to handle the issue of missing values. So missing values can occur because of a lot of reasons, basically 3 main reasons. One being that the value is not, you know, it does not exist. Like, for example, if I'm conducting the census, right, I'm collecting data by making use of the census data. So it may happen that in there is a column called as number of siblings. So under that particular column, if I, for example, say I do not have any siblings, right? So basically that value does not exist. So I can either mention it as 0, or if upon data collection, I just leave it as empty, then I end up with something called as a missing value. Okay. So in this case, the value is missing because it does not exist at all. Right. The second scenario would be the value does exist, but it is not known. Okay. For example, again, when I'm collecting the census related data, lots of people, you know, the elderly people, if you ask them their date of birth, they do not have much idea about it. Okay. They might just tell some random date, or some of them might not even know their date of birth. Okay. So in that case, if you see, if I end up with a missing value there, that occurs because the value does exist. Everyone, each and everyone has a date of birth. But if I do not know its value, I just leave it empty. Okay, so that is the second case where I get a missing value. Third case would be because of a human error. For example, I've recorded the value, but I forgot to save it during my data collection. Okay, I have the value exists and the value was known, but I forgot to record it. Okay, so in that case, what happens is I'm ending up with a missing value. That's because of human error, right? So because of the presence of missing values, what happens is in the later steps, especially during modeling of your data, you know, when you're running any models on them, that time you end up with some issues in accuracy. So we have a term called as GIGO. Has anyone heard GIGO? If yes, you can just message me on chat. Has anyone heard of the term GIGO? Okay, so basically GIGO, GIGO, it basically stands for garbage in, garbage out. Okay, so what do I mean by garbage in, garbage out? If I feed my model data that is not clean, okay, when I say garbage, I basically mean data that is not clean. If I feed my model a data that is not clean, my output will also be something that is not correct, that is not right, that has less accuracy, right? So you always need to keep in mind that it's always good to have a lot of data, okay? The more the data, the better it is, okay? But it's not right that you have a lot of data that is not clean. So in the process of cleaning, you might have to get rid of some data that is making no sense because you know it will affect your model at the end, or data that has a lot of missing values. You have to get it. So obviously that reduces the size of your data that you have collected. But it's always, you know, you'll have to take a trade-off there. Okay, so it is always at the expense that in the end, you're getting a model with better accuracy. Okay, so once you're done with this very tedious step of data preparation, you move into the exploratory data analysis step. So basically, this is the step that we'll be talking about today. Exploratory data analysis is nothing but using visualizations like charts, graphs, okay, such options to understand your data. So I'll just show you an example of the COVID-19 data that we have. The data is in the form of a table. And if I ask you to get some insight from that table, it's going to be one hell of a process. It will be a very tedious task. Okay, but if I do the same thing in the form of a chart, in the form of a maybe say bar chart, right? It's there right in front of your eyes. You don't have to read through numbers. Reading through numbers is always the difficult task. Okay, so those kind of analysis steps that we perform using visualizations is what is called as exploratory data analysis. These steps help us gain a better idea about the data that we have collected. I'm getting messages saying that I have not, I have admitted everyone. I don't know why, it's all showing joining.
Yes, ma'am, at most participants are 100. So since it is in the waiting room, no problem, ma'am. You can continue.
Okay. So the next step after data analysis, exploratory data analysis, is the modeling part. This is where all your machine learning algorithms, they come into use. Okay, you pass in your data to that particular model which you have developed, and then based on, you know, the training that you have given, if it's good enough, then you'll get a test data that based on that you can test on your data, and depending on the kind of data that you've given, depending on the parameters you've used in your model, you'll get a accuracy, and then depending on how good your accuracy is or how bad it is, if you want, you can alter the parameters and create better models so that you get better outputs. Okay, so basically when I'm doing any of these, what I'm trying to do is if needed, the analogy that I use is, you know, comparing it to how a baby grows, right? So when a baby is born, they don't know anything. That is the case with the machine learning algorithm also. You're basically making the system or the machine learn for itself, similar to a baby. So in the beginning, they don't know anything, right? The babies. And then slowly and steadily, you teach them bits and pieces. They try to make sense of it by themselves. And then when you give them, like, for example, you show them when they are growing, you show them pictures of cats and dogs, right? And you tell that this is a cat, this is a dog. So initially to the baby, everything looks similar. But as and when you are training it later on, after the baby is kind of well trained, then by itself, when it sees an animal, it can distinguish it as being a dog or a cat. That's the same case with the machine learning. Okay, so you're basically teaching your machine, which has no idea of what a picture would be. You're teaching it or training it based on a lot of data that you have collected. And depending on the features in the picture, it distinguishes between whether an animal is a cat or a dog. Once you train it and then you give it an image, then it can properly classify whether that particular animal is a cat or a dog, right? That's how there are lots and lots of steps. So I'm not, that is one another topic entirely as such. So I'm not going into details of that, because basically we are sticking with this exploratory data analysis. And then moving on, you have your evaluation. If it's suitable, it's fine enough, then you can go ahead and perform your deployment. Right? So this is the entire data science life cycle. The next thing that we'll be discussing is web scraping. Okay, so web scraping, like I said, is basically a method to collect data where we go to websites, we go to web pages, and basically we scrape their data. So think of it like, you know, for example, you have a surface on which there is some, you know, some sort of a formation of something. And basically what you're doing is scraping from that surface. So this is similar to that. Okay, that's how the term came. So you're going to the website and you're just collecting the information that you need. Okay, so that website would have lots of websites. They're usually done if it's in the HTML format, it will have a lot of tags, the CSS tags, all the stuff, everything will be there. So from all that, you just require data that is useful to you, right? So that's what we do in web scraping. So in Python, you have lots of libraries available. For example, there's Scrapy, urllib, Python request, Selenium, beautiful. So lots of such libraries are available that aid you in web scraping, right? So the library that I have basically used for the project that I'm going to be showing you is nothing but Beautiful. Okay. And after you have done your web scraping, basically you have the data in your hand. The data that you have in your hand is in the form of a data frame. And on that data frame, so basically what I have in hand is raw data. Right. So when I make use of different methods for converting my raw data into something that can be used for decision making, and that would be called as the information. So when this raw data is converted into information, that is what we mean by data analysis. So in this particular case, we are doing something called as exploratory data analysis, which I mentioned, exploratory data analysis is nothing but making use of visual methods or visualizations that if you may. So making use of such visual methods to analyze your data. Okay, so your data would have a lot of information hidden in that, right? So it is the data analysis step that helps you in retrieving this information. So for that, you might have to summarize all the characteristics that are present. And one way to do it is using exploratory data analysis. So there are Python offers a lot of visualization libraries also. The most common and the simplest one is Matplotlib. And then we have Seaborn, Bokeh, and there are others also, right? So basically for this particular project, I've made use of the Seaborn library. Right? So before I go into the Tableau part, I'll just show you what can be done using Python. Okay, so in using Python, how you can perform your visualizations. So here, this particular work has been done using the IDE called JupyterNode. So I believe all of you are already into Python programming. For your, academic purposes, you might be using different IDEs, or maybe even the shell would suffice for you. But when it comes to, making presentations as well as coding, I prefer the IDE called as Jupyter Notebook. So this particular work has been done in Jupyter Notebook. So the advantage here is that I can, you know, write my, I can do presentations as well on this, right? So for example, all I've done here, I have done the coding also, so you can see that. And I have just hidden the code cells so that this looks like a good visual, you know, presentation. So all my code cells are hidden. But anytime if I want to make any changes, I can just go back to the code cell and change my code. Otherwise, these particular cells are nothing but markdown cells, and I'm using this for, you know, writing any text kind of information that I want to write. So for example, for example, this particular notebook, Jupyter notebook, is used for COVID-19 data analysis. So what I've done is, I have gone to this particular website, and from this particular website is actually holding information of this particular website is used for getting the information for my scraping project. So this has information about all the countries in the world, the number of cases, COVID-19 cases that are being detected, the deaths that are being recorded, and how many people are recovering from, you know, the in different countries. So that is the data that is available. And from all these, so they themselves have done some sorts of visualizations and all that. So from all this, what interests me is this particular table over here, right? So you can all see this table here. This table is for all the countries in the world, all the cases that are being detected. So this gets updated frequently. This particular step, this particular page, it gets updated frequently, and then I can use this page for my scraping purpose. This is lots of information is there about all the countries. You can see this, right? So from this, I want only information that is required for my scraping purpose. So what I do is I have written the code accordingly so that I get access only to this particular table. Okay, and even from that table which you just saw, it had lots of information, right? So we don't need all the information. I required only the total number of cases and so on, so details. So I have scraped only that much of information. You can see that. But now when I scrape, what happens is, you can see under the country table, you can also see continents coming up. So the table that was there in the website, it had also segregated the information based on the continents. So I'm not going to make use of that. Okay, so this is the kind of unnecessary data that I need to clean. Okay, for example, this the names of continents, different continents coming up, right? And now you can see here, it's how is it recording the new cases? It is recording it like this, plus 3816. So when I want to do any analysis purpose, new cases and all, I would like to treat these particular values as integer values or float values. But when symbols like plus, comma, such symbols come up, what happens is these values are treated as string values. So when it's treated as string values, I will not be able to perform any mathematical operations or any statistical operations on this, right? So what I would want to do is, in my next step, which is data cleaning, I would want to get rid of all these issues, right? So I have written a function for the data cleaning step. And once I execute that function on my table, you can see now all the data that I have available is clean. Okay. So wherever the countries, in the countries column, instead of having any of the continents, I have cleaned it and made it into just the countries. Okay. And now you might be wondering, why is it showing new cases as zero? So basically what I've done is, wherever there were no values, like for example, you can see, this plus symbols, they were coming only for the continent wise. Okay, so wherever there were no values, I have changed it to zero. Okay, so that might not be the situation now, but this would change as and when the website gets updated. Okay, so at every day during at 10 o'clock, the website gets updated. So at that time, the new cases will be added. Maybe if I run this after some particular time, if the updation has happened, the values in my table would change. Okay, so right now I'm just using this particular data frame or this particular table for performing my analysis. So for example, what I've done is I have taken the 20 countries which were worst affected, right? So based on the total number of cases, the higher the number of cases, the worst affected, the more it is affected, the country is affected. So I have taken the 20 countries, 20 worst affected countries. I have created a subset of my original data, and then I have used it to create this particular visualization, right? So if you just look at this table here, it's pretty difficult for you to make out. So I can see that, okay, USA, it's at the top. It's at the top of the table with almost 176,000 cases. Sorry, it's more than 17 lakh cases. Okay, and then the next thing is Brazil. So Brazil is just having 4 lakh cases. Okay, so you can see from the number itself, it's clearly visible that it's a huge difference between USA and Brazil. But with the rest of the countries, it's not so very clear because the numbers are kind of close, right? But if I convert this particular table to a chart or a graph like this, then I can see easily see that it's there right in the picture itself. I don't have to read through the numbers in the table, right? So that is the use of performing your data analysis by making use of visualization, right? So from this picture, it is clear, right, that USA is having the highest number of cases and it's the worst affected country, but compared to the rest of the countries, you can see the number of cases, the number of cases that are the second affected country is drastically less compared to US, right? And the same with the rest of the countries. So you can see India, I believe it's somewhere over here. So last time when I executed this particular, I think last week, that time India was at this point. Okay, now because the cases have increased, obviously it has gone higher up in the chart. So you can see the extreme difference between the first most affected country and the second most affected country, right? And similarly, on a similar scale, you can also plot the death information, so the number of deaths that have been recorded in each country. Again, we have first converted into we have just retrieved a subset from the original table, and that has been used for creating this particular visualization. Okay, so here you can see that although in the previous graph you had seen that Brazil had the second most number of cases detected, but you can see that the number of deaths in Brazil is not in the second place. It's in UK, which is higher than that. Okay, so that is how you can visualize. So you can see, so from this, basically what kind of an analysis can you make? Even though the number of deaths number of detections in a country is high, it's not necessary that the number of deaths need to be high. Okay, so what I've done is to basically, study both these concepts together, I have combined, again, created a subset of the data first, and then combined the data into a single graph. So basically, the bars, they are used for checking the number of detections or the number of cases in a country. And this red line chart is for determining the number of deaths. Okay. So although Brazil has the second highest number of cases detected in the country, it is the number of deaths in the country is not in the second place. That would be in UK. So you can see this. First is obviously in US. The second one is in UK. That's where your line is peaking again. Right. So that was the visualization that we made. And the second thing that we tried was using a heat map. So like I said, all the data that we had in hand, we had converted into integer values. When we were doing the cleaning step, we have converted all the values into integer values. Yeah, someone has asked me if I can share the IPYNB file. So I have a, I'll be sharing my GitHub repositories link at the end of the session. I have this IPYNB file stored in that. Right, so you can get your hands on that, and obviously if you want, you can work more on this. Right, so yeah, so this basically is for showing the correlation between the different values that we have collected. So I would not want to comment much on this, because when I scrape the data, I was not able to detect any of the new cases. But you know, if I execute the same thing, maybe at the end of the day, I would have a better correlation between the different values that were collected. Because ideally speaking, even when I executed it yesterday night, the total number of active cases and the total number of total cases and the active cases, that was highly correlated. Okay, but over here, you know, it's not that clearly visible. It's basically because when I scraped the data, it was not showing any new case. So maybe once you get your hands on the IPYNB file, you can execute it at some time maybe at the end of the day or something. So in that case, you'll be able to detect the number of new cases, the actual number of new cases, and then this particular heat map would make much sense. Even otherwise, this particular heat map is used for showing the correlation between your different columns. So if a column is highly correlated to another column, it appears in a lighter color. And if it is not highly correlated, it appears in a darker color, right? And the last one that I did was using this geographical plot. Okay, so this requires a little bit of work, in that you need to get the codes that are associated with each of the countries. So like, for example, you can see white colors occurring over here. This is not because the data of the country was not available, it's because the code that was used did not match. Okay, so sometimes if there's a change in the country name and it's using a new code or anything of that sort, you end up with code that doesn't match. So that's why I have like white patches here and there. Now, this is just the oceans, but otherwise in between the continents, if you see white patches, that's the reason. So this basically is for showing again, you know, the concentration of cases, concentration of the confirmed cases in a country. So higher the number, it'll appear more in yellowish color. Lower numbers will appear in bluish and purple color. So the only place that is coming in yellow is USA, because the number of cases is extremely high there. And the second highest would be in Brazil. So that is coming kind of that is coming in the next place. Right? So what we saw in the bar chart here, we have done it using a geographical plot. So because of that, you know, huge difference between the cases in USA and Brazil, none of these colors in between can be seen. Okay, because it was such a huge difference. So the highest one is coming in yellow, and the second highest one, it's coming in this purplish color, and all these colors in between, they're actually it's not, you know, visible at all. So if it was a gradual increase in the numbers, then you would see a even more colorful kind of a geographical map. Right, so why I showed you this was just to know, just for you to appreciate the capability that Python has in plotting such graphs. Right, so this was done entirely in Python. Like I said, it was done using Jupyter Notebook. The codes have been written. So I'll be sharing the GitHub repository name at the end of the session. So maybe you can go and get your hands dirty on that data. So the next thing that I did was, so like I said, for the Jupyter Notebook file, for the Python coding, I scraped the data from the World Meter's website and made use of the data. But for the work in Tableau, I actually collected ready-made data which was available in Kaggle. So Kaggle, I believe all of you must be knowing, this is a repository like UCI repository. It's got huge collection of data and you can get your hands on the data that is there. And you can make use of it for any of your data science works, projects. So I got the data, which was specifically data on India, the number of cases detected in India. So that was the data which I got. And I have used that to create a dashboard. So I'll show you how that is, how I went about doing that. So basically, if you have not heard of Tableau before, there are a lot of tools available for business intelligence and visualization. Tableau is one of the tools. So there is ClickSense, there is Power BI, so lots of such tools are available. Tableau, the advantage is it is pretty fast. Okay, it's a powerful tool, and because of the way it can, it's basically a drag and drop interface, so it makes the process of creating your visualizations very easy and interesting, right? So again, what we are doing here is we are making use of the raw data that was available and we are converting it into visualizations for better understanding. Okay, so with Tableau, like I said, the advantage is that it's pretty fast, right? So I'll just show you how it was done in Tableau. So this is the interface for Tableau. So as you can see, Tableau, it makes use of worksheets, right? So every time I create something, I create it on one of these sheets, right? So I have created different charts on each of these sheets. And then finally, what I've done is I have clubbed it all together into something called as a dashboard. So with the added features that are available in Tableau, what I've done is I have created a kind of an interactive dashboard. So the software is so these are the different charts that I've created, and I've clubbed them all into my dashboard. A pretty heavy software. This might take a few minutes. There are lots of applications running. I'll just show this to you on a full screen mode. This is an entire dashboard. And on this particular dashboard, I have a lot of information available, right? So for example, this particular chart is for showing in India, state-wise, if I look, what are the number of cases that have been detected? So the orange one is basically showing the number of confirmed cases. So it's already showing in the tooltip, the number of confirmed cases is 52,667. The number of cured cases in the state and the number of deaths that were recorded in the state, right? Similarly for all the other states. Okay, this particular map here, like we saw the geographical map for the world, this is specifically for India because my data was, solely used for Indian data. And here, these bubbles, they are used for indicating the number of confirmed cases. Okay, and the color of the bubbles, you can see these different bubbles have different colors. That is basically to determine the number of cured cases. So higher the number of cured cases, darker will be the color. So see, Tableau, Tableau is completely different from Python. So Python is basically a programming language. And in Python, what I did was I used basically a lot of, you can make use of the visualization libraries. But again, when it comes to Tableau, I would just want to demonstrate this to you so that you can appreciate the kind of work that you can do with Tableau. So I can make this. So I can just execute this particular dashboard. Okay. So you can see that the dates, and so I have collected the data from 30th of January. Okay. And you can see that the dates, they are changing for every day, whatever date cases were recorded, that's being changed. So initially you can see there's a small dot appearing in Kerala, right? That's because the first of the cases was detected only in Kerala, and the rest of the states did not record any cases at that time. But as you can see, maybe by March end and all, you can see that the entire country started recording cases. Okay, the entire country started recording cases. And as the number of cases are being recorded, you can see that the circles, the dots, they grow larger in size. And even the cases are being, the number of cases that were detected, that gets changed. Okay, so this kind of feature is, it's the advantage that you have when you're using Tableau. Okay, so Tableau is giving you this advantage of using, kind of an interactive, on kind of an interactive basis you're able to. Okay, so I hope all of you saw how the graph was able to change by itself just by the click of a button over here. Okay, I just accidentally clicked it again. So maybe if you want, you can just look at it once again. Like I said, first dot appeared only in Kerala. And then slowly the entire country started recording cases. Okay, so in a similar fashion, you can create the data collected over different dates. Okay, so again over here, orange is for determining the number of confirmed cases that were detected in the country over the different days. So you can see that the graph, so I believe all of you must be hearing to this particular concept in the news that the curve hasn't flattened. You can see over here, the curve is still rising, has not yet flattened. So the orange one is the curve that needs to get flattened first. So this is the curve that is showing the number of confirmed cases. This is basically the number of cured cases, and the red ones are the deaths that are being recorded. This is basically grouping your data age according to age. So if you fall into one particular age, how many people have been detected in that age? This is segregated based on the number of males who were affected and the number of female patients that are there. This is country-wise data, right? So this particular dashboard, it's at one glance, you're able to gather a lot of information that is available specifically to the COVID-19 data set of India. Right? Okay, and by making use of the features that are available in Tableau, you can make it a very interactive dashboard. Okay. So yeah, coming back to the question that someone had asked me, they had asked me whether Tableau and Python are different. So like I said, they're completely different things, and they're basically, Tableau is specifically used for the visualization purpose. Okay, so it has the specific use alone. And if you want to, talk about analyzing time series data, then I would always go for Python only. So for the analysis purpose, yes, you can always use Python. But once you have the data in the required format, then maybe you can come back to Tableau and make, interesting advanced graphs like this. Okay. So that was about the session. So if you have any questions, I'll be open to them. Yeah, and since you had asked me, so this is the repository. I'll share this in the chat. If you have any questions, you can throw them open at me, and we can, depending on the time that is available, maybe I can answer a few questions.
Good morning, ma'am.
Yeah. Go on. Hello. Okay. So meanwhile,
can we connect? Any two data sets in
your voice is breaking. Can you type it in chat? Your voice is breaking. I'm not able to make your question. I can't hear your question. Can you just type your question in chat? That would be very helpful. Okay, so Ms. Meena has asked me whether customizations can be done in Tableau. Lots and lots of customizations can be done. It's a very, very useful tool.
Two data sets and we have visualization.
Can you connect two data sets? Is that your question, ma'am? Hello? Okay, the second question is from Kausalya. She's asked me if this is open source. So basically, I'm not sure which you have asked. So Tableau is basically a licensed software, but they are very generous in that they are giving a 1 year free period for students and faculties. So you can make use of that feature that Tableau is offering. So for a year, you can make use of the Tableau software. So basically, it is a licensed software. And someone has asked me to give some tips to students to study and improve their knowledge. So tips, if you want, I would just want to say the most important thing that you need to keep in mind when you're doing any sort of work, in any field or even when you're in your education, is to get involved in it. And how you get involved is by having interest in what is being done. Okay, so as long as it doesn't interest you, it's always going to be very tedious task to go through the stuff. But what I believe is every subject has a beauty of its own. Okay, so even I used to have difficulty in studying theoretical concepts, but I realized that theory is where I can, exercise my brains for grabbing information. Okay, so gaining practical knowledge, maths and all, it was always very interesting. Usually it's interesting for all the people because, it's always maths and such practical programming, logical concepts, they're all interesting. But when it comes to theory, that's where I think, you can make use of techniques that help in improving your memory. Lots of memory techniques are available. So, for example, there were some MBA subjects which we had. Basically, it involved a lot of points to keep in mind. So, that's where you would want to exercise your memory technique. So that's one way you can make these subjects interesting. So, as a tip, I would just say, if you find a way to make the subject interesting, then you will always want to get involved into learning. Okay? Is it possible to connect two or more data sets? No, there is no limitation of that sort. Ganeshan, there is no limitation. You can connect any two data sets. If you're talking about Python, there is a function called merge that is available. It works similar to the, joins that we use in database systems. And even in Tableau, you can make use of two data sets. The only restriction would be you're basically creating a data source. So you should have one table that is the primary table, and the additional tables that you're creating, it should be able to be linked to the main table. That is the only limitation. But if you're able to perform that link, then you can connect any number of tables. Okay. And I believe someone has two data sets integrated. I believe that's the same thing, whether you can link to tables. So like I said, data sets also, tables, whatever you want to call it, it can be done in Tableau, provided you are able to give a common column between two data sets. Okay. Okay, so I have got a feedback saying that it was a good session. Thank you very much for that. Kausi has asked me if it is possible to do DNA analysis. Yeah, DNA analysis, my God, that is one area there where you can do it, right? Like huge, huge amounts of data, bioinformatics, whenever you're working. So you have all the gene-related data, the work that they're doing on reading the human genome and all the other genomes. So that is always a source for a lot of useful data. And yes, you can do a lot of analysis. You can use that data for predictions as well. Okay. Meena has asked me what is better visualization better for visualization, Tableau or Stars? And what about the coding part in Tableau? So yes, Tableau requires a little bit of coding now and then, depending on what kind of work you want to do. Which is a better tool between Tableau and Stars? Each has its own, this thing. SAS, again, compared to Tableau, it's more expensive, okay? And frankly, I cannot comment much on SAS because I've not used it personally. If I can do something with SAS, then I prefer using Python for that, right? So I'm not sure whether I can actually comment properly on that, but I feel Tableau is comfortable enough. And it is the one that is trending right now.
But what's the difference between data mining and data science? I think that there was not a such huge difference between that. Both are same. Data mining is about extracting knowledge, and from data science, it's all about model deployment. In both, that is data science and data mining, in both EDA exists, which is exploratory data analysis. But what's the huge difference between that, ma'am? Data mining and data science.
Okay, see, when the main difference that I would like to say is about the modeling concept that we're doing, right? So when you're talking about data mining, yes, it is extracting information, but it's basically based on the patterns that is available. Okay, so when I'm data mining, I'm not applying the machine learning techniques that I have in the field of data science. Data science, I would like to say it as one big, one huge circle, and there are lots of small subsets in it, right? So data mining would be a subset of it. Machine learning is a subset of it. Artificial intelligence is a subset of it, right? So if you find any similarities, that would be because data mining is a subset of data. Okay, data science in itself, if you look at the definition of data science, it clearly states that data science is an interdisciplinary field. Okay. You cannot say data science is something that is standalone. You have to have the knowledge of different fields to be actually able to, work as a data scientist, right? So it makes use of scientific processing. It makes use of statistical computations. So all, knowledge from a lot of fields is actually clubbed, and that's when you're able to work on something that is a data science concept, right? So I hope that was, I was not able to catch your name. It was just showing us don't care. So whoever it is, I hope that particular idea is clear. Okay.
Yes, ma'am, I got it. And another query.
Yeah.
Is it possible to do this?
Ma'am, your voice is breaking. I'm not able to catch your question. Can you just type it on chat? Okay, and the time, it's already time up. So I just wanted to share one more thing. I just asked Someone has asked me whether Tableau is free. So like I said, it's a licensed software, but you can get it for free for one whole year. Okay. And improving knowledge in Python. Okay. So, you know, there are lots of sites like HackerEarth, HackerRank. They conduct a lot of competitions. So not only Python competitions, there are competitions conducted in any area of your choice. Maybe if you can participate in these competitions, it helps in improving your knowledge. Okay, that is one way that I would recommend. And before I sign off, I just want to show you this video. So Aegis School of Data Science is conducting a data science congress, right? So it's a huge event where more than 50 plus global speakers are gonna be joining. I just want you to just look at this video. Right, so like this was visible from the video that I showed you, lots of Indian as well as international speakers will be joining for this event, which is scheduled to be held on June 6th and June 7th. So you can register for the event at this website, datasciencecongress.com. And if you're actually interested into data science, because, you know, from the video itself, you can see lots of, you know, celebrity speakers are coming. One of the highlights is about Kilo Robots. So there is Toby Walsh who's coming. He's working against the use of killer robots in military and other areas. So that is one very interesting topic. And similarly, lots of other interesting topics are there. So based on your likes and interests, you can register and you can, attend the talk, whichever you feel is interesting for you.
Okay.
So, yeah. So I think my time is up. So it was a great session for me.
Okay.
I want to thank you all from the bottom of my heart, from the bottom of my heart for giving me this opportunity.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll hand it over to Sudha ma'am. And meanwhile, I'll share the link for your website, right? Thank you guys, thank you all of you.
Thank you ma'am. Yeah, good afternoon to all. It gives me the immense pleasure for proposing the vote of thanks for the webinar on COVID-19 analysis using the Python and Tableau. Thank you for all. I render my heartfelt thanks on behalf of our management, principal, vice principal ma'am, and dean sir, for their continuous support and the real assistance rendered for making this event a grand success.
Yeah.
Thank you all. I extend my sincere thanks to our head of the department and all my staff colleagues for the Department of CSE, so who are giving support to this. And thank you all. I also extend my thankful to all participants from various colleges who made this event a grand success. Also, I would like to thank the person behind the technical supports and all others who have contributed directly or indirectly for the successful conduction of this program. Once again, I thank you all. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. So participants, you will be getting the feedback link through the WhatsApp group as well as your Gmail account. Okay, go ahead there and complete the form. You'll be getting your e-certifications. If you have any doubt, please post your questions on your WhatsApp group, and or else you may contact the coordinators, Mr. Anand Kumar sir and Mr. Kovindan. Thank you. Thank you, Anandal. Thank you, ma'am. We can leave the meeting now, ma'am. Okay. I'm unable to hear you, ma'am.
Sorry. I have been assigned as a co-host. That's why I do not have the leave option meeting.
Okay, ma'am. You can end the meeting, ma'am. You can end your meeting. Yeah, okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, e-certificate. Ma'am?
Gracias.